to talk you through it. I just want to say you're very welcome here to the three colleges, and I just want to thank Sheena for being the guiding light, for putting this program together, for being the inspiration, and also to Wendy Short and Gabrielle Grigorieva for being such able and capable managers and administrators of the event. One more thing, if there is a fire alarm, it is not a drill. You have to go out of that door over there, you have to go back in the direction where you have coffee, you have to go down the stairs, out the door, and assemble outside Tate Britain. So it will be a real fire alarm. That's it. Over to Sheena.
Thank you so much for that introduction. Okay, I'm going to make some very short comments this morning, just because I'd rather hand over quite quickly to the speakers for the day. Good morning, thank you all for coming today. Obviously, some of you have traveled far, I really appreciate it. I'm just going to say a few words about the background for this event and its intention. I was once told that the reason philosophers return to examining language again and again is because, and I quote, "Language is the interface between us and the out there." And I've often contemplated the importance of this statement and returned to it in my own work in a number of different ways. It seems to me, however, that this statement and this relationship becomes more complicated, not less, as technology progresses. So this event emerges out of a long-standing personal interest of mine and examines the following questions, among others. What is language as a primary human technology? And how are both language and us being changed due to the rise of artificial simulated language systems? This may or may not be the case, but it's a question. In short, what is language when it's made by machines rather than human beings? Language and thought are, according to philosophy, fundamentally tied. But if this is the case, how does this relationship change when machines are the ones doing the speaking? And how will this affect us in the future as these systems become ever more sophisticated? I am polite, overly polite, to my Amazon Echo for reasons which defy my own rationality, but have something to do with Ken Hollings once saying to me, and I paraphrase from memory, Ken may want to correct me, one day these technologies will grow up. And they won't appreciate the way you spoke to them when they do. About right, Ken?
I think something like that. If we say and do, we should do with the mind that artificial intelligence will one day judge us.
Thank you. Thank you, and I know it's just code, but so it doesn't hurt to be civil, is what I took from that. But I think that's really interesting because we can't detach these questions about artificial language from the rise of artificial intelligence. And there are people here better posed to speak about that today. So with this overall intention in mind, across the day we will hear and see presentations from a number of fields of study, and also the same questions are being approached through the artworks and performances this afternoon. So I invite us to start the day with the wonderful Ken Hollings, and I hope that you find the day interesting, thought-provoking and pleasurable. Thank you, Ken Hollings.
Oh, look at that. I get my own extra slide. That's terrific. Thank you so much for that. First of all, thank you so much, Sheena, for that wonderful introduction, and also to everyone who's been involved in setting up this conference, for inviting me here today. It is an absolute pleasure and privilege to address you all this fine spring morning. What I'm going to talk about is a particular wave of activity that occurred predominantly during the year of... Wow, when did I go to that slide? Around about 2013. At the time, I was finishing work on my book, The Bright Labyrinth, Sex, Death, and Design in the Digital Regime. It's been ready for publication, and I'm going to be reading some extracts from the book during the course of this presentation. And while I was working on it, there was this strange wave of Twitterbot activity concentrated around 2013. It fluctuated in intensity, and it reminded me a great deal, to begin with, of the kind of flying saucer or UFO flaps, as they were called, that occurred in the 1950s and 60s, where suddenly there'd be a wave of saucer activity, a lot of people would see them, then the sources would disappear again. And these Twitter bots were doing pretty much the same thing. And they were of a fairly typical arrangement. Wow, all those lines are different. This is a typical example of the kind of Twitter bot activity that was occurring at this time. Twitter bots essentially come in packs and they come in waves because their basic program is to aggressively follow people on Twitter and then aggressively stop following them again. So it's a kind of, they play hide and seek with subscribers' timelines. And this is one of the few beautiful occasions when three Twitter bots all actually intersected with each other. Essentially, they just put out cues, try and get a response if at all possible. In this particular case, we've got Olivia Taters and not Keith Calder having a completely inconsequential conversation, which may or may not be about friends or parks and recreation. Hard to tell. But we do get some beautiful sort of breakthroughs here, like different are soft. It's beautiful. Suddenly, the game goes up a notch because not Keith Calder suddenly makes a reference to the Bank of America, which brings the Bank of America bot into the conversation straight away with, hello, were you able to get the problem resolved? I'd like to help. Now, the beautiful thing about this is that absolutely no information is being exchanged whatsoever between any of these entities. They're just responding to stimuli all the time. This, however, is fairly coherent compared with the kind of experiences that I'm going to relate over the course of this lecture and where I think we can find the background for understanding some of this behaviour. Now, this is a typical example of the kind of Twitter bots that started to appear in 2013. What immediately gives the game away is the fact that there seems to be very little connection between the name, the picture, the background, and the descriptor. I have met many freelance writers and probably a few beer experts in my life. None of them look like that. None whatsoever. And also, I don't know what the Tetris background has to do with it either. This is clearly, this person does not exist. And, you know, if we wanted any further information, we can see that there is no connection whatsoever between any of these tweets that she's putting out. I mean, for freelance writing, you'd think they could get the word Bobby slammed play spelled correctly. You know, coming out with homophobic remarks, God knows what this is about. So I just got fascinated by these normal people that were just spouting gibberish. And what was interesting is over the course of the year, the breakdown of language got stronger and stronger until, I don't have a screen grab of this, but check this bad boy out. This is from Bokadamu Relilo, and she wanted the world to know that all to do find is that you, your all is so wonderful, not it's we on I, this me, we get half up, your one, me, your why, my, we all was of they. Fabulous! You know, this is an incantation. This is the, you know, what the alchemists would have called the prima materia of language suddenly coming into being, sort of asserting its own life. This is on borderline of magic. This kind of ritual chant coming off the internet, and it reminded me a great deal of the early cut-up experiments that were being carried out by the British artist Brian Gyson. And the American writer William Burroughs during the 1960s and 70s. While checking the ventilator in his restaurant, the 1001 Nights of Tangiers, one afternoon in late 1957, Brian Gyson found a charm made up of mirror shards and seeds stuck together with various bits of biological goo. Inside it was a text laid out in a Kabbalistic grid. May Massa Brahmin leave this house as the smoke leaves this fire, never to return, the invocation read. A few days later, Massa Brahmin was, by his own account, out of the restaurant business, out of Tangier with a shirt on his back, and heading for Paris and lodgings in a cheap hotel. It was here in the cold spring of 1959 that he chanced upon the cut-up method while slicing through a pile of newspapers with a Stanley blade. Along the axis of each cut, the layers of printed text formed themselves into sequences of randomly juxtaposed words from which new meanings emerged. Busily lashing together the typescript of The Naked Lunch in the room below, American novelist William Burroughs hailed Gyson's discovery as initiating a project for disastrous success. The rest of the story tells itself. On the magical plane, according to Adorno and Horkheimer, dream and images were not mere signs for the thing in question, but are bound with it by similarity or by name. The relatedness of things from which the earliest forms of poetry are derived eventually gives way to the politics of intention. Like science, magic pursues aims, Adorno and Horkheimer conclude, but seeks to achieve them by mimesis, not by progressively distancing itself from the object. Magic, in other words, is eroticized action. Poets have always understood this better than most. Poetry is created not with ideas, but with words, Stefan Mallarmé affirmed. To go further and see poetry made up of 26 letters is to glimpse the remains of the magical formula that was once hidden within it. Typographical text exists as a biomechanical entity. Both a tool and an instrument, the typewriter transforms the arrangement of words into a grid to be manipulated. What once formed the basis for magical practice now offers itself up to being sliced through, collaged, and juxtaposed. Texts are therefore edited into existence, both as part of the world experienced through the senses and as something quite apart from it. The cut-up method, as applied by William Burroughs to his own writings, becomes a more violent expression of the editing process, a breakthrough that looks forward to the point at which text, sound, and image are no longer separated from each other, but converge in the pale glow of a laptop screen. This shift begins when the magic of the typographic grid is animated by the intervention of the tape-recorded word. Consider this machine, Burroughs wrote of the tape recorder. It can record and play back, activating a past time set. In other words, it summons ghosts. Through its mediumship, Burroughs intersects literate typographic text with radio and TV voices, the angry noises of the street, and the grotesque banalities of modern consumer culture. Anyone with a tape recorder can influence and create events, Burroughs insists. Masked presences swarm through his work. The invisible brothers are invading present time, he observes. Invading present time was never going to be either a systematic or an orderly affair. As a process, it has all the turbulence, all the formless violence of smoke. What we're tracking here, Burroughs writes, is how does a word become a picture, and how does a picture become a word? In either case, you know it is happening when something clicks. For a picture, the click is like a camera shutter. For a text, it is more like the click of a tape recorder switch. Listen for that click. Describing the tape recorder as an extension of the central nervous system, Burroughs' recommendation that his readers tape an experience in order to get it out of your head and into the machine echoes Thomas Edison's remark that the phonograph knows more about us than we know ourselves. This transfer of awareness reveals how little we actually perceive. To play back events recorded on tape, Burroughs argues, is to discover that there was a grey veil between what you saw and what you did not see. That grey veil was the pre-recorded words of a control machine. A believer in progress, Burroughs may call the pre-recorded universe into question, but he never doubts the reality of the playback equipment itself. The need, which might resist central control, Adorno and Horkheimer argues, have already been suppressed by the control of individual consciousness. Burroughs conjures up the reality studio to illustrate the proposition that all human experience has been programmed before the fact. Most of what we see or do or say has been scripted and recorded beforehand. Recorded sound links existence with non-existence, the animate with the inanimate. Other recordings may already exist that we are not as yet technologically equipped to play back. Thanks to the surface noise of contemporary mass media, a world of unforeseen events has become an integral part of our daily reality. The energy of recorded sound is not constant, but like sexual energy, renews itself through rhythmic repetition. Running a recording backwards and forwards, Burroughs argues, randomly cutting in new words and sounds, alters its predetermined dynamics, allowing unfamiliar events to reconstruct themselves from the electromagnetic silence. So it seems to clear to me that Burroughs' strategy, the one that Dyson was presenting to, is an attempt to sort of break up the programming of the human machine, the kind of preconditioned removal of the need to break free, as Adorno have identified it. And I find it very interesting that this kind of breakup of control is occurring at the linguistic level and has to do so. And I think it's also significant that the interception point, our entry point into this investigation, comes through this interesting flip that occurs in the 1960s and which was identified by Marshall McLuhan in the move from the kind of mechanical media of type and the typewriter into the electronic regime of the tape recorder. And with it, there is a move away from visual culture, script-based culture, text-based culture, into one based on sound. And Burroughs was, I think, positioned at exactly the right point to observe how language changes in this transfer from one technological medium to another. And I think it's a significant transfer as well, because it puts language on the margin of its own existence. And it reminds me, in that state, of a comment Mary Douglas makes in Purity and Order, published about 1967, around about the time when Burroughs is making his experiments, where she says, you know, existing on the fringe, on the outer edge of a cultural society, in a state of transition, is also a state of extreme danger, because you have no boundaries anymore, you have no order to what is going on. And I think the precise kind of correlative for this marginal state, this condition in the fringe where you call between states, is ectoplasm. Ectoplasm was incredibly popular in the late Victorian era, right in the early years of the 20th century. Essentially, it was something that a practicing medium was able to conjure up during a seance. Ectoplasm was essentially the missing link between matter and spirit. It was kind of in between materialization. And curiously enough, its heyday coincided with the rise of popular photography. So in other words, ectoplasm existed almost to be photographed. It exists best in images like this particular one. And I became really fascinated by this substance that seems to be in the process of coming into being, but it's not quite there yet. It's not fully materialized. So it's on the edge of its own being. And it reminds me that just as I saw in Burroughs at the kind of conjuring up of ghosts from the tape recorder, from the machine, in the same way, I think we have to look at the ghost itself as a kind of machine. Ghosts, like machines, have no choice but to haunt the present. Their actions are traditionally described as fragmented narratives trapped in time, moving images of eternity obsessively repeating themselves. There is a play of inhibition about such spirits. They are compelled to do what they do. In fact, no new medium has ever really proved itself until it has been effectively used to communicate with the dead. Spirits rap on darkened tables in Morse code. The Ouija board acts as a typographic arrangement of ghostly influences. Exposed photographic plates encrypt light while matter and transparency exchange roles. Marconi and Oliver Lodge claim that their discoveries can help the living get in contact with the dead. Death becomes a sensory affair, involving a simple change in the human wavelength. Evangelist Amy Semple McPherson has herself buried inside a telephone box so that she can call her followers from heaven and let them know what it's like up there. Thomas Edison develops his improved blue amberol phonograph while at the same time announcing plans to work on a device that can be used to communicate with the dead. Simulation requires the smooth running of rhythmic engines, driving out all imperfections and inefficiencies in the form of ghosts that can no longer be mistaken for anything else. Every advance in the technology of sound reproduction shows up the inefficiencies of what went before, isolating them as a phenomena in their own right. What sounded to earlier ears like a perfect and faithful playback now seems alive with scratches and hums and clicks. The signal-to-noise ratio shrinks perceptibly, and the audio range is soon buzzing with unexpected messages. Electronic voice phenomena, or EVP, is the term used to cover a wide range of sounds, utterances, and intrusions of unknown origin that have somehow managed to register themselves upon our consciousness through existing communications channels. Many consider EVP as a means by which the dead speak to the living. It is only as a recording that they come into existence. The dead display a meaningful lack of consequence, however. Their words seldom make any sense, often taking the form of riddles, veiled allusions, or cryptic asides. Try listening to Edison recite, "Mary had a little lamb," the first recorded words ever to be played back successfully on a mechanical device. The shock of his voice reaches across the years. That humans and machines might interact with each other to produce some inhuman communication remains an intriguing proposition. For writers like Burroughs, it opened up the possibility that a new kind of audiovisual poetry might emerge, or at the very least, be better understood. Caught somewhere between a nursery rhyme, a song, and an engineering test, Edison's first recorded text involves a phantom presence that has been with us ever since. Speech has escaped its boundaries once more, and everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go. There's a moment when all technology seems new, but the truth is that it's already haunted before we get to it. History reveals ghosts drifting through its delicate processes. In 1971, William Burroughs publishes Electronic Revolution, a tactical treatise on how to use sound, text, and image to trigger profound cultural upheaval. That same year, the Latvian psychologist Dr. Konstantin Radiva publishes Breakthrough on his researches into EVP, documenting disembodied entities that appear to be communicating with the human race through radio waves, television, and tape recorders. An accompanying vinyl disc contains Radiva's recordings of unknown voices from a hidden dimension, speaking in polyglot tongues, expressing themselves in the same oblique, fractured poetry that Burroughs had obtained from Geisen's cut-up method. Whatever their origin, the tone of these messages is often sarcastic, elusive, ominous, even threatening. Voices from the dead invading present time, they offer cryptic warnings of the sorry state of human affairs, hinting darkly at future events. Furthermore, they express no doubt whatsoever about who's in charge around here. "We work the switches," a mysterious radio voice informs an EVP researcher in no uncertain terms the year after Breakthrough first appears. Whether the product of electromagnetic pollution or subconscious apprehension, EVP constitute the advanced signal from a technology ready to self-destruct. The voices of the dead establish an anti-environment in which we become alienated from the pre-recorded world around us. However, it's a lot easier to start trouble than to stop it, Burroughs dryly remarks, as we finally prepare to take leave of our senses. Suddenly, ghosts are no longer enough. It's the total possession of the medium itself that is important, a rendering of human consciousness. How random is random, Burroughs asked, referring explicitly to Radiva's tape experiments. We know so much that we don't consciously know that perhaps the cut-in was not random. Code is the strategic organizing of behavior, exposing the workings of rationality by running its component parts out of sequence. A code is therefore not a text, but a process that resides outside of that text, just outside. EVP's cryptic messages drift through disorganized airspace. They constitute a random rejoinder to the strict regulation of broadcast media by which everyone receives a one-way mass communication to which they can never respond. EVP are the product of electronic media feeding back on themselves. Controllers reveal the pre-recorded mirage, an encoded social impulse played back on streets and movie screens, in cities and living rooms, across newspaper headlines and television channels. The scrambling together of mind and machine brings about the end of the human psyche as a cohesive whole, leading in turn to the diffusion and disappearance of humanity itself. As smoke leaves the fire, never to return. A phantom universe of digital pictures and text is slowly replacing the voices of the dead. And I think you can see now why ectoplasm, veils, smoke all become very important correlatives to this state that we now find ourselves in the digital regime. I had a very interesting experience where I saw the kind of digital and the mechanical clashing with each other through the world of the spirits a few years back. When I took part in an experiment with two composers, musicians, Alexander Golkowski and Michael Esposito. Now, Golkowski specializes in Victorian sound reproduction devices of all kinds. He has a magnificent collection of Edison phonographs, actual cylinder players and recorders. Michael Esposito works with digital technology, and he spends his time recording ghosts. And we carried out this session in Polkowski's studio, so it was surrounded by Edison machines. And what Esposito asked is that the two machines should be switched on, one playing back nothing, the other one recording. And he would use an MP3 recorder, and he was going to interrogate the room, and so, as he would say, warm it up a bit. And it was a really fascinating moment. We spent about 10 to 15 minutes just standing in this room with these Edison machines just churning the sound. They make an amazing grinding noise as they're at work. And Michael sort of would inquire, we'd ask the room questions. And
And at the end of it, we had a playback, and so we're listening to this. And suddenly Michael goes, "My God, did you hear that?" And I go, "No, I didn't hear anything. I was honestly, no, I didn't hear anything." And we played this bit back a few times, and Michael's absolutely insistent that there was something there. And then, and I'm really addressing the graphic designers in the room at the moment, then I have this moment, you've got to imagine this kind of almost like grinding white noise. And suddenly a text just emerged out of negative space. It was like the text was actually in the silences between the noises. And I distinctly heard a voice say, "I want the machine to work." Whoa! It was an amazing moment. It was an outstanding moment. And you know, you can chalk it up to just the quality of the sound. You can chalk it up to Esposito being very good at working the room in the fullest sense of the word, in the sense that he was massaging me and Alexandra about that. But I swear, that voice just suddenly clearly addressed me. And I thought, this is just the perfect message. And I haven't had another kind of flesh call moment like that until I started to encounter the Twitter bots of 2013. How are we doing for time? Okay. I might be bringing this into line earlier than I thought, but that's fine. I'm gonna read, this is adapted from a blog post that I put up on the 4th of May, 2013. Over the past couple of months, I've become increasingly fascinated by a type of Twitter spam that seems to resemble the EVP messages transcribed by Konstantin Radivan. These take the form of tweets received from accounts that belong to what I can only describe as non-people. The obvious clues are that these non-people suddenly turn up unannounced in your list of followers with no corresponding notification of their status anywhere else in your account. The handle and the picture of this new follower rarely match, male name and picture of a female being an obvious example. And the short self-description often includes repetitive and contradictory statements. If you examine their profile a little more closely, these accounts usually have just 22 tweets, occasionally 20 or 21, but I've yet to see one with more than 22. The tweets themselves are usually worth examining, as this is where the strangeness really starts. They can take the form of mangled quotations from actual authors, alive or dead, as if put through some weird syntactic blender, such as, "He need regarding knowledge, such as thirst for money increases previously while using diet, Lawrence Stern." Can you think of a more appropriate author for that statement, Lawrence Stern? Or they play with the logic of language in a manner that would have appealed to Wittgenstein. Organic mathematicians framing it carefully. What would he have made of that statement? Or they merely collapse meaning altogether and turn into a rhythmic form of Dadaist sound poetry worthy of Tristan Tzara or Kurt Schwitters. Out is I, is, get to a, they, when, is that, your, what, that, with, they. Beautiful. At present, I'm not inclined to draw any conclusions about this phenomenon one way or the other. I do have some thoughts as to their origin. The first is that these non-people started out as one of the thousands of artificially generated followers intended to extend the reach of some corporate enterprise or media sensation. However, they have somehow broken free of their lonely non-existent crowd and are now wandering the Twitterverse in search of someone to follow and have fallen into your orbit. Or it may be that they have somehow replicated themselves and it is the digital echo of their non-presence that has now decided to follow you. One aspect of their behaviour that supports this assumption is that a non-person will sometimes attach itself to a conversation you're having with one of your real followers, as if they were somehow hovering on the edge of your exchange, shy but anxious to take part. Their contribution would, I suspect, turn out to be entirely unsettling if it were ever allowed to take place. One thing is clear to me at this stage. These digital non-people constitute a new form of being that does not inhabit the same dimension as ours. Do they have anything to say to us? That, I would suggest, is another matter for another time. This is the time. Let me close by noting once again that it is only through examining how a network is distorted that we will get a true sense of how it behaves. Spam already tells us more than we want to know about ourselves. The EVP spam coming from, or perhaps through, Twitter may take that uncomfortable understanding to a whole new level. Shortly after posting this on my blog, a message showed up in my Twitter timeline. Hesitation, you might, but certainly not yourself.
Later, I corresponded with the writer and editor, Simon Sellers, on the subject. He included an account of our exchanges in the foreword he wrote for my book, The Bright Labyrinth, and I'm quoting from Simon here. I tweeted Hollins's post to my followers, and it became one of the most clicked and retweeted links I've ever discharged into the Twitterverse. Maybe, I tweeted to Hollins, it will make its way to the non-people. He replied, the non-people know where to find me. So they did. A few days later, he told me a bot called Murty Weldy had started to follow him, and that he had searched for its name online, but the only Murty Weldy he could find was a woman who had died in 1868. Many spam bots are affixed to names that are as syntactically blended as their tweets. So why was this one scraping actual names of the dead? Could there really be a connection to actual EVP? Or was it, as the Bright Labyrinth describes, remembering all things all the time, the digital self will be resurrected only as memory? More moments of high strangeness were to come, a wave of oddness that Hollins took in his stride. A friend showed me his Tumblr, which he had made to collect examples of hipster spam bots. Bots that try to pass themselves off as social media gurus, or in their words, social media ninjas, or social media mavens. Their tweets are faux ironic declarations of love for beer, bacon, zombies, and problem solving. Pop culture as profession, hipster obsessions, bacon mostly, are the popular professions for this class of bot include Bacon Ninja or Bacon Evangelist. They don't link to or sell anything at all. Not even bacon. I showed Hollins the Tumblr. What did he make of it? He responded, Googling Bacon Evangelist produces 11 million results. Some quite surprising. This later prompted me in turn to note that Twitter bots are the absolute cut-up masters of the 21st century. They generate the kind of dark matter of language we're inhabiting today. And I have to say, it's interesting that the bacon-loving Twitter bots have now disappeared entirely from my timeline. They disappeared as suddenly and as unexpectedly as they arrived. And of course, you know, it's not hard to think that, you know, there are more sophisticated versions of Twitter bots now who can actually, they have a little bit more control over their syntax and their grammar and their cultural references. And I think it's some sad way that the poorer for it. The kind of improvement in bot behaviour and bot activity very much reminds me of the same kind of improvements that were taking place in the development of high-fidelity sound during the 1950s, 60s, and 70s onwards. So in other words, you know, when you got yourself a brand new Bang & Olufsen stereo system in the 1960s, you could look back derisively at Thomas Edison's Blue Amberon machine and go, oh God, listen to the amount of surface noise on that. It's terrible. I laugh at this primitive technology. At the time, the Blue Amberon was being sold on the fact that you couldn't tell the difference between a mechanically generated voice and an actual natural one. They would do public demonstrations in which a soprano would stand behind the screen singing, and then she would stop singing and they'd switch the phonograph player on, and audiences couldn't tell the difference. I'm pretty sure we would tell the difference today. We would know. But what's kind of interesting is that it's also like we have habits of listening which have nothing to do with taste, they have nothing to do with cultural sophistication. There's almost a physiological habit of listening. When I was with Kolkowski and Esposito, the reason I was there is that Kolkowski wanted to record me reading a passage from one of my books onto an Edison player. And it was for an online, the irony is it's for an online project, so you record your voice onto an Edison player and then he uploads it onto a website. And you may find it hard to believe, but I don't actually like listening to my own voice, and I don't like listening to recordings of my own voice. The only recording I've ever loved of my voice is that cylinder recording. I mean, they're really hard to make. I mean, I didn't fully understand why, when you hear early recordings, they tend to talk in a very formal, centaurian manner, slowly emphasizing every frigging word. And I thought, no, it's just the manner, but actually that's what you do. If you want to record onto wax, which incidentally has to be melted, if you want to record onto wax, you've got to enunciate really clearly. Otherwise, it just doesn't make it. It just does not get into the system. It doesn't get onto the machine, out of your head, onto the machine. And when I heard the recording played back after the cylinder cooled down and hardened, I suddenly remembered this wonderful comment that John Cocteau had made about hearing himself reading poetry, called an optical photograph. And he said, it was as if the machine was speaking with my voice. And that is exactly the experience I had. Your voice has a brain because it's literally been scraped out of matter, out of material. It has a brain, you can feel it. It's like a nervous tingle up your spine when you hear it. And it's not my voice anymore, it's the machine's voice. I have no illusions about that whatsoever. So I feel the same way about these early Twitterbot exchanges. You know, they still give me a shiver, even though they're not around anymore. And they remind me, considering this is only, what, 5 years ago, they remind me of a different way of reading, a different way of understanding text. And so I'm going to end with just a moment, a very, very brief moment, but it kind of just pulled the whole thing into focus for me. Because Simon and I have been exchanging these about, what's with bacon? Why do they always mention bacon? Where does this thing come from? Is this some kind of code? It was really, why? Didn't make any sense why there would be, you know, why you would want a bacon evangelist. And I was walking through a shopping mall in Southwest London, thinking about this thing. Deep in thought about it, and actually, I was trying to remember what I was in the shopping mall for, to be honest. But it was at this time, and suddenly I heard this voice go, "Hi, do you want to take a ride with me?" And I kind of whirled round. What? And it was Peppa Pig. It was a Peppa Pig ride, you know. And there she is, and she was. You know, I said, no, she's just on a loop. She's just on, you know, this is just a thing in a shopping mall, and it's not even for me, it's for kids. And I was like, I just happened to be in the right place at the right time, in the most receptive frame of mind possible, that when I hear a voice saying, "Hey, want to take a ride with me?" I turn around, and it's Peppa Pig. And I thought, that's the bacon connection. That's what connects the Twitterbot with a kid's ride in a mall in Southwest London. That's it. It was leading to this point. And then I suddenly thought, my God, we hardly communicate at all as a species. We think we do. We think we're really good at it. But actually, we're really bad at it. You know, we should value when we can communicate. We should value the exchanges that we make, even with Twitterbots and children's rights. But quite often, it's down to circumstance. It's down to just picking up a specific cue. Not really listening to everything else, but a bit like the Bank of America bot. You know, we just listen to a conversation and maybe someone will mention our equivalent of the Bank of America and we'll be in there. Oh, you've got a problem, with your account today. And in a sense, the thought I'd like to leave you with, and the thought maybe for the morning and the afternoon, is what is the autonomy? You know, where does our autonomy exist? Once we start to examine language, it seems to me that language becomes more autonomous, becomes more willful. Incidentally, did you notice in those examples from Rowney that Burroughs had pulled at random from the book, and I had pulled at random from Burroughs, the word "here" appeared in every single one of them. It was not intentional at all. It was only when I put them together, I go, my God, the word "here" appears every time. So there is, you know, these patterns emerge, you know, a bit like the voice out of the white noise saying multiple machines work. These patterns emerge, but I'm not sure how in control of them we are, or whether we're still at the moment in that state of amazement. I think somewhere in the same book that Adorno and Horkheimer wrote about the sort of magical mimesis of language, they come up with this wonderful phrase. They say the gasp of astonishment is usually the first name for the unknown. And I think I would like to end my keynote presentation. Again, it's been an absolute honour to open today's proceedings. But I would like to end with the gasp of astonishment, and maybe we can explore it and unpack it and astonish ourselves during the course of today. I thank you so much.
Thank you very much for the talk, very interesting. I was thinking on the Adorno quote, and my first thought straight towards Freud and displacement of conversation, but then I remembered Spinoza talking about the prophetic. I wondered if you thought perhaps these spam bots are performing some kind of prophetic function, or can perhaps in the future perform some kind of prophetic function.
Yes. In fact, there's a wonderful quote. When Burroughs talks about the cut-up, he actually says at one point, you know, cut up the past with the present and the future leaks in. So in other words, Geisen and Burroughs saw that, you know, in these grammatical syntactic breaks in the text, they thought this was a point where something else could leak in. It might be the future. I think we don't spend enough time actually acknowledging divination, even though we're quite happy for statisticians and pollsters to make predictions. I think that it's something we're actually quite good at in recognising and establishing patterns, but I think providing it's dressed up as statistics, it's fine. But if it's the Delphic Oracle speaking with a double tongue, suddenly we step away from it. So I'm sort of in favour of I am in favour of a kind of healthy involvement and engagement in these pieces. Just as in the same way Peppa Pig helped me in my own thinking. You know, I had to be prepared for it, I had to be ready for it. So perhaps, I know it wasn't Spinoza who said fortune favours the prepared mind, I think it was Emerson, but that would be my position. Yes, why not?
Thank you.
Oh, actually, on the subject of Freud, very quickly on the subject of Freud, it does occur to me that, you know, in progress in civilization is discontent, we'll probably get the best definition of this kind of sort of psychic representation of the human in terms of its relationship to communication technology, where, you know, Freud sees telephones, radios, phonograms, cameras as being the embodiment of, or the materialization of memory, that at their heart they are concerned predominantly with memory. And then he comes up with this wonderful definition of the kind of technological humanity, and he describes us all as gods with artificial limbs. And I think I've yet to see a description that betters that one in terms of the continuity that exists between us and our own classes. Use the spirit horns, come through to me. Send me your ectoplasmic message.
One's not working. I was interested in obviously you were referencing people like Burroughs and the cut-up and how new connections are formed through seeing new patterns and so forth between words. In relation to the spam bots, obviously new connections are formed, but they don't know what they're doing, and you can see these new connections forming. I was wondering, have you thought about how this could be harnessed for creative ends? This form of, obviously Burroughs in the end is in charge of the connections that he's making, right?
Yeah.
So it's not a fully kind of smooth space way of creating a cut-up. But the Twitter bots are, in a way, because they don't know what they're doing. So how can that be harnessed for human creative ends, is my question.
I must admit, at the moment, I'm a bit more at the sort of James Bridle end of this, where it's kind of like, you know, herd them all together and let's just see what they do. You know, I mean, I'm more interested in the idea of getting two or three Twitter bots all communicating with each other and seeing what happens. You're right that Burroughs, it generates raw material. I mean, he's more interested in breaking up habits and occasionally producing the most extraordinary poetry. But he himself said at one point, using the cut-up method, you're not going to get choirs of angels singing stock market tips. You know, a statement which echoed, I think, Robert Desnos in the 1920s, 1930s, talking about automatic writing with the surrealists. And he said, if you produce banal nonsense through automatic writing, it's still banal nonsense. Those two statements seem to echo each other very well. Personally, I felt I was already beginning to, by creating a narrative out of their activity, was trying to interact with them on that level, but I totally take your point. That we should be working with them while they're there.
And secondly, I think we should be prepared to do something that maybe I'm not completely prepared to do, and which Burroughs is not completely prepared to do, which is actually let them get on with it. You know, let's just see what they do, and then we'll maybe learn from it. That's my idea. I think that we have to sort of, we have this habit of, for example, I was at the Science Museum earlier this week, and I got fist bumped by a robot, which was a pleasurable experience. I mean, it wanted it. It actually said, let's fist bump. And I was actually saying to it, I have no idea what I'm saying to you right now, do you, while we're doing this? And of course it didn't. You know, it's just a program. But it's just a more sophisticated version of Peppa Pig, really. Just more manly. And, you know, I thought, you know, this is the prejudice I think we have to overcome. This notion that, aha, I'm conscious, you're not. Because there's been some interesting work amongst theoretical physicists who are now postulating the idea that consciousness itself is just a state of matter, and that in the end we're still boring down into this sort of prima materia of existence. So in a way, the best thing I think the Twitter bots could do is maybe get us out of this rather, and I hope this whole conference get us out of this rather sort of prejudicial view that, you know, we're conscious and you're not. Whereas I think actually our consciousness is far more limited and far more habitual and far more repetitive sometimes than what the Twitter bots are capable of. So I think that would be a good thing. That would be a win.
Have you tried looking at, I don't know if you can even find this information, but how many spam bots are actually out there on Twitter?
Gosh, no. I have read some papers. I mean, the figures are alarming. There are more of them than
you realize. I feel like if you define language as just, you know, this mass confirmation bias where people agree that this one way of talking makes sense, if you have more spam bots than you do people on Twitter, could that change the way that even people talk? Or could that kind of drive forward language in a new direction where we might not necessarily have control over, you know, what we decide, how we decide to communicate?
I think, if I understand what you're saying, it's almost like, are you saying that the Twitter bots could actually constitute a kind of linguistic community in themselves?
Yeah.
And which I think would be amazing. I'm totally in favor.
Well, I guess my question is, how do we know that's not already happening now?
Well, if you remember in my meetings, I actually said there are probably recordings in existence we're just not technologically equipped to play back yet.
Yes.
So I'm leaving the door open on that one. You're absolutely right. How do we know? We don't. We absolutely don't. And, you know, again, going back to the origin of these things, when you consider that they were designed to basically sell you stuff initially, you know, or to swell the followings of some individual. The banking evangelist movement could still, you know, I've got high hopes for them in 2018 in the midterms. I think the banking evangelists are going to sweep the board against the Republicans. It could definitely happen. But again, it might also involve us having to think about language in a different way. So at the moment, I'm moving more towards the idea of looking at languages as a technology, you know, rather than some kind of, you know, divine receptacle of meaning. And, you know, if we can look at technology, we might also have to look at it as a magical practice as well. And I'd be very much in favour of that. I think, and also, I think anything that breaks down the kind of established literary forms with the assumptions that go with them, I'm totally in favour of for the 21st century. Absolutely. Have I answered your question?
No.
Yeah. I mean,
it's okay to say no, because I've already dissed the whole prospect of communication anyway between human beings. So.
Well, I think that's what's interesting, is if you think about communication, if you say that humans are bad at communicating and then we're looking at these spam bots not understanding what they're saying, I mean, there must be something going on there. If they're replying to each other, there must be a set of logic, set of rules that are being placed for spam bots to respond to each other. We might think it's very banal the way they're doing it, but I think there are more and more chatbots out there that seem a lot more similar to us. But I feel like once it reaches that stage, I just, how can you tell? There must be a point in time where we can't comprehend the shift in language. And I just wonder how much of that is actually already going on now, and how much of that is kind of like yet to come.
I'm really glad I don't have a definite answer for your question, because it would just invalidate probably the rest of this program of talks. I think that's one of the big inquiries. I think it's definitely something that we should be looking at, whether we use statisticians or programmers to get as close to that understanding. But I think it's definitely, you know, duty now for the future. And I think it's not enough to just dismiss them as, you know, some failed piece of communication technology, because we're failed pieces of communication technology. And if anything else, at least it allows us to sort of maybe not see ourselves as being the sole inhabitants of this linguistic universe, because we're not. I think someone wanted to make a point at the back of the room.
I was just going to say, for a long time we've thought that animals haven't had a consciousness, they haven't been able to communicate. And now we do think that, and there are a lot of vegans. And if you think, I mean, it's just interesting to like compare the two, because obviously we didn't create animals, but at the same time we didn't understand them and their ways of communicating until much later on. So I was thinking maybe it would be interesting to think, you know, we're starting to figure out ways of interpreting the way that animals communicate, starting to come up with ways of interpreting language in a completely new abstract way that we hadn't understood before. So maybe eventually we would be able to actually communicate with them, which would be interesting, or at least be aware that they are communicating independently from us in a different way that we can comprehend, which could be interesting.
I think that there's nothing you said that isn't completely congruent with the things of my talk. My only point would be, why would animals possibly want to communicate with us? Why would they want to? And that is actually very back to your question. You know, I mean, I've been assuming that these messages are for me, you know, because they're in my timeline. But they may be, you know, there's a wonderful story. I think I've just got time to tell. It's a short story written by Alphonse Allais, the French absurdist writer, in the late 19th century. And it was the time when Lowell was talking about the possibility of canals on Mars, and what it was all going to be. So they build this enormous telescope so they can look closely at Mars, and they find that there's patterns forming on the surface of Mars. And they watch them over time, and they realize that it's actually someone laying out a message in enormous rocks and boulders on the surface of Mars, in Martian. And so they transcribe the message, they get their most brilliant mathematicians and linguists to work on decoding it, they figure out the language, and the message is, hello, how are you? And so, you know, they create their own message. You know, people of Earth greet the people of Mars, you know, this is a great moment. And they go to the Gobi Desert, and they lay out all the stones, and there's this message there, and then they wait for 6 months. And then the new message starts to appear on the surface of Mars, and they're all, I'm going to end this because it's such a killer line. The message starts to appear, and they take the message to the mathematicians and the linguists, and they're busily decoding it. And then finally they get the message, and it's, we weren't talking to you.